This is the day. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice in it.
Amen.
Shall we pray? Dear Heavenly Gracious Father, we are so blessed that we have this opportunity to bow before you this wondrous day. Thank you for all the blessings you have brought upon us, especially the gift of your Son, Jesus. Bless this cup or this bread, for it is the bread of life that was sacrificed upon that cross. And this we do in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Let us continue in prayer. O gracious Heavenly Father, we are so honored to be here with you this day, and you are with us this day. Please bless this cup, for it is the blood that was shed upon that cross. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
So how many here have never in their lives been fishing? Anybody? Everybody has been fishing. How many here have never caught a fish? There you go. All right, so a lot of people go fishing and don't catch a lot of fish. But for most of us who have gone fishing, whether we've gone a lot or just now and then, we know that things don't always go perfectly, right? So take a look at some of the things that can go wrong. You can turn it down now. In the hands of their fathers and hired workers to do it. The most amazing thing is they don't actually know where they're going. They think they do, but they really don't have a clue. Would they have followed Jesus if they did know where he was going and where he was leading them to go? They probably wouldn't have been ready to do that at the time, but they didn't ask any questions. They just followed him, okay? So kids are dismissed now. So we moved to California by way of a small town in northwest Washington, and then western Montana before that, Tennessee and Arkansas before that, grew up in a small town. And we did spend a couple of years in Germany after college, but the culture there was very different, more like a small town in some ways. And there are lots of significant differences in lifestyle, but by far the most noticeable between the small towns that we've lived in Montana and in Germany is the pace at which we feel compelled to live in California. It's almost taken for granted that this pace is a completely negative aspect of the California lifestyle, but that's really not true. It's neither good nor bad to simply live at a slow pace or a fast pace. There can be advantages and disadvantages to both. There are certainly extremes of both that are not healthy. But the pace of life itself is a moral neutral. The problem is that we may just seem to be moving so fast in California that we don't take time to distinguish between the urgent and the important. And this is increasingly not just a California thing. It's a problem that extends to the whole American culture, and especially young families in our culture. We refuse to accept that we cannot do it all. And if we make more money or move to a different location or get a more comfortable car for our commute or get another app so we can do all of what we need to do in the car, you know, that's all it will take. You know, just a few minor adjustments. You know, this will make us more efficient so that we'll be able to increase our workload and still leave the office a little early to make it home in time to put the frozen entrees into the microwave, walk the dog, get the kids to soccer or baseball or ballet and gymnastics, run 3 miles, you know, or go to the gym, stream a movie, pay the bills on your app, of course, and then, you know, tie up a few loose ends on your computer so it'll be ready when you arrive at work in the morning, and then you take a sleeping pill so you don't waste any time, you know, lying awake. And so we do this 5 days a week, often at least half a Saturday, and then do some house cleaning, yard work, catch a movie at the theater, have dinner out. You know, we think we can do it all, right? For those of us who are followers of Jesus, how is it different? Well, our lives are often very much the same as those around us, except that we do go to church on Sunday morning when we're in town. While they go to the beach or to the mountains or to the desert or to Las Vegas, a little more often than we do. And then when they do stay in town, then they have another day, a lot like Saturday, while we only get 2/3 of the day because of church. Okay? Well, there are certain dangers that accompany any pace of living. One that accompanies a slow-paced lifestyle is a tendency to be suspicious of progress. Small town problems, two very significant small town problems are a resistance to change and a suspicion of newcomers. In a slow-paced society, even obvious improvements and corrections may be seen as a threat. In a small town, newcomers may not be seen as potential new friends, but as outsiders who do not understand the way things work. You know, so a major problem, on the other hand, where life is lived at a faster pace, usually more urban places, is that of misplaced priorities. So this is not the opposite of the problem in a small town, but it is a different problem of similar magnitude. It's a product or a byproduct of living on the edge. So larger churches in larger cities may have fewer problems with changes or new ideas, but when it comes to commitments of time and energy to help other members focus on what is most important or meaningful, then those larger churches or the people in them can be as defensive as some small town churches are toward new ideas, even when the commitments in the larger church suggested are right and good commitments. Okay, so we read, we read through verse 15 of Mark 1 last week, but let's back up to verse 14 and start there. After John was put in prison, this was John the Baptist, Jesus went into Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God. The time has come, he said. The kingdom of God is near. Repent and believe the good news. As Jesus walked beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the lake, for they were fishermen. Come, follow me, Jesus said, and I will make you fishers of men. At once they left their nets and followed him. When he had gone a little farther, he saw James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John in a boat preparing their nets. Without delay, he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men and followed him. Okay, so what did they think they were doing when they followed Jesus? Can you imagine Jesus walking up to a Californian at work and suggesting that we drop what we are doing and go with him? You don't think that's a fair comparison? Well, okay, it's not quite the same, that's true, because those were family-owned fishing businesses. You know, they could come and go as they pleased. They had employees, hired men, and James and John had their father Zebedee, at least to carry on in their absence, so maybe they even had a little money saved up. They tended to live in family clans, and their families wouldn't let them starve even if they didn't agree with the choice that they had made. But even more significantly, their families probably did support the choice that they made. Still, why in the world would Simon, Andrew, James, and John drop their nets and follow this man? And why would their families probably support their choice? Well, since we know what happened to them later on, we might think that they loved Jesus, and they were ready to follow him to their deaths. But at this point, that is not why they followed him. They may not have known him, hardly at all. Now, in a word, the reason that they followed him was for glory. They had visions of grandeur. Now, if this seems too cynical, it should be added that their visions of grandeur were grounded in their faith in God and in his promises as they interpreted them. They believed in the promises God had made to Abraham for at least as long as before their time as Jesus came before our time. In other words, a couple of thousand years before. And so God had made Abraham's descendants his special people because Abraham himself was called to leave his home and to follow where he would be led by God. So in their minds, it was appropriate and even more, or even expected, that a sacrifice would be a part of any role in the return of glory to Israel. But we should make no mistake when we ask what motivated these men. There was a very self-centered hope and expectation among all of the Jews of their day, not just these men, especially though in Galilee where these men lived. Because these people were very oppressed. They were not ruling themselves as you would expect the children of the God of the universe to do. That's how they thought of themselves as Jews. Instead, they were ruled over by heathens who worshipped Greek and Roman gods. The people who worshipped these pagan gods actually held themselves to a higher standard than the gods themselves lived by. They also worshiped their own living rulers as gods, and these rulers were pathetic examples of the depths to which human beings could sink. And a mixed breed man named Herod, who called himself a Jew, which was a really bad thing being a mixed breed to the Jews, he was given the region of Galilee along with the title of king, and he was living with his half-sister as his wife. They were very poor, yet they were paying nearly half of their income in taxes to this corrupt government and its corrupt tax collectors and rulers. Roman soldiers were allowed to require them to carry their packs for a mile whenever they chose. They were allowed to worship their god, but in a temple that was built by Herod's grandfather and presided over by priests who were appointed by the Roman government rather than by God, priests who didn't even believe in angels and spirits and life after death. So the common people were looking for a Jew to rise up from among them and lead them in conquest over the Romans and the entire world. And this leader would be a righteous man and a descendant of King David, the greatest of kings who ruled the Jews before they were overthrown and overrun by various heathen empires. But the Jewish prophets who had warned the Jews that they would be overthrown because of their horrible disobedience also told them that this deliverer would someday come and restore the kingdom of David. And then it would reign forever. It would never fall again. So since most of us know something about what Jesus did and what he taught and how he ultimately died, it isn't easy for us to see him in the way that they saw him, as a potential military ruler. In order to understand what went through the minds of Simon, Andrew, James, and John, we have to erase our image of Jesus and see him for a moment as they saw him. He wasn't quite just another man, but he was a man. At this point, Mark wants us to be impressed with the fact that they would drop their nets to follow this man. He wants us to be impressed with this. You know, he had been baptized by the most popular figure among average Jews, John the Baptizer or the Baptist. He wasn't a Southern Baptist. He was just the one who baptized. But John had said that he was preparing the way for someone much greater than himself. And then he identified this guy named Jesus when he came to him, and Jesus was from this town called Nazareth in the region of Galilee. When this Jesus was baptized, something happened that certainly didn't happen every day. You know, there was a spirit descending and a voice from heaven. So they didn't know much about him yet, but nothing they did know would eliminate the possibility that he might be that military leader, the deliverer they were looking for. In fact, what John had said and what had happened at his baptism made him seem like the best candidate running, for sure. So if they heard that themselves, they may have been there when Jesus was baptized and heard that voice, or if they just heard about what God had said, you know, that voice, "You are my son whom I love," they surely would have taken that as a great sign, right? But after all, they were all sons of God. See, they were children of God. So this man who called them was obviously not the Son of God, not in a literal sense. So when they dropped their nets to follow Jesus, in their minds, they were joining his army. They expected to go through some training, but they were more than willing to be the first recruits, especially since this implied that they would be his chosen leaders in the army and then in his government when he set it up. So that was the way it worked. Everybody knew that, and yes, they were common men, but they were almost certainly recognized, actually, as leaders within their own communities. They were hardworking, reasonably successful business owners who would have had the physical strength and the endurance that soldiers would need for long campaigns and hard-fought battles. Their fishing trade could even contribute to the supplies a large army would need. It's often been said that Jesus' choice of followers was very surprising and remarkable. And there are many ways in which it certainly was, but the idea that these four would be chosen for what they expected to happen was probably not so far-fetched to them or to those around them. Now, even though they expected that there would be something in this quest for themselves, there was still a tremendous risk in being associated with anyone who would even attempt to lead any Jews in a revolt against their own regional authorities, much less the Roman government. So even though they didn't really know where they were headed, Simon, Andrew, James, and John did choose what was important over what was urgent. So what factors are at play when we are forced to choose between the urgent and the important? The reality is that for everything important to our relationship with God, there is something urgent to distract us. Sometimes these distractions are temptations to seek pleasure or power or money. But sometimes these distractions are actually other good things. Many distractions are good things. They're just less important things. More often, perhaps, these distractions are neutral things, neither good nor bad in and of themselves. Many distractions are neither good nor bad things. They're just less important things. So what is the most important thing? Jesus later will be asked that question. And we know the answer that he gave. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. And that's the best answer for life, you know. But as we look at the situation that Simon, Andrew, James, and John were in at that moment, the answer to the question of what was the most important thing was following Jesus. That was more important than their businesses. It was more important than their safety. It was even more important than their desires to be with their families. But I want to argue that following Jesus is what leads us to love God and love our neighbors. Following Jesus is how we learn to love God and our neighbors. So, what seems so urgent that it keeps us from following Jesus or causes us to turn away as we follow Jesus? Well, let's start with one of those good things. Taking care of our families is a very good thing. Can that good thing, though, keep us from following Jesus? Well, yes, it can. On the other hand, following Jesus will actually make us better parents and spouses and children. So it's not really a choice between Jesus and our family. It's a choice between flawed ideas about what our family needs most and what they really need most. If we think that our family most needs to live in a comfortable house and ride in cars that aren't embarrassing for a kid or a wife to be seen in, you know, we might choose to work long hours or do business in a cutthroat or even dishonest way. We might choose to barely be involved with a church family because it takes too much time. Or we might choose not to be generous when money, when giving money back to God for the sake of others. One man that Brenda stayed with as a college student when we were on when she was on a mission trip before I knew Brenda in Germany. This man was married to a very faithful follower of Jesus, and in Germany, to be a follower of Jesus in the way that we are was a big decision. You weren't just a part of a big church; you were a part of a small church that involved making some real serious decisions. But this man would go to church with her, but he never became a Christian during the time that Brenda knew her, and he explained this. He was a salesman who sold school supplies to schools and districts. But he told Brenda that he couldn't be a Christian because he had to be deceptive and dishonest in order to be successful in his business. Well, God showed him an extra measure of grace by letting him live long enough that he finally did become a follower of Jesus. But that was only by God's grace. The truth is that the best thing we can do, though, for our families is to love God. The best thing. Following Jesus in every attitude and action will sometimes mean that our kids and even our spouses don't get everything they want when they want it. But it will never mean that they don't get what is really essential. You know, our love and our example of love for God. But we can be distracted by that good thing if we lose our focus of this very reality. Okay, let's look at something that is neither good nor bad in and of itself. How about a satisfying job or career? According to the latest statistics, about 65% of Americans are satisfied with their work. Only 20% of them are passionate about what they do for a living. This is interesting. So the question is, what would help most? Do we have the sound on back there? Is Mike back there?
Was there something you wanted?
Well, I've been here at Cheers for quite a while now. I'm a good worker, I don't take vacations, I'm never sick, and I was just wondering...
No, what do you, I have to stop you right here. I cannot give you a title.
Title?
Yes, I know you deserve it, but the front office just doesn't let me hand those things out.
Oh, Miss High, you don't understand.
You know, sometimes people work here 10, 15 years before receiving a title. How can I justify giving
you one? Miss High, I want a raise.
Oh, is that all? That's fine, I'll see you tomorrow.
Just like that?
Well, of course. I thought you came in here to beat me out of a title, but if you just want to settle for money, well, that's fine.
Wait a minute. Let's just stick with this title thing.
No, Woody, you said you would settle for a raise. Now, I'm going to hold you to it.
Oh, no, I blew it. I should have demanded a title. Money gets spent, but titles are forever.
No, Woody, I told
you... Oh, God, Miss Al, you're not going to palm some raise off on me. I deserve a title.
Woody, I've met some tough negotiators in my life. All right, you deserve it. I'll go to the mat for you. Congratulations, you're the new senior bartender.
Get out! Senior bartender? Wait till I tell my folks. They think I came in here asking for a stupid little raise and now this. I just hope it doesn't go to my head. Oh.
That's what's nice about you, Woody. Nothing ever goes to your head.
Is this back? Okay. Believe it or not, almost 83% of employees said that being recognized for their contribution to projects makes them feel more satisfied than getting rewards or gifts. That doesn't mean that people don't care whether they are well paid, but what we often want most is to feel respect and appreciation. We want a sense of self-esteem and maybe even significance. Well, that desire is not a bad thing, and pursuing a satisfying career is not a bad thing, but it's not really a virtue to be ambitious for every promotion or every job that brings more status. That's why Betty chose to go ahead and retire instead of pursuing being a general. That's the truth. But it's not really a virtue to be ambitious for every promotion or job, or job that brings more status. So self-esteem is important, but the best thing that we can do for our self-esteem is to love God. Jesus was meek and humble, but he did not lack self-esteem. That voice from heaven after his baptism certainly didn't hurt. He didn't get a raise, but he was recognized for who he was and the contribution he was making to God's project. When it comes to career and work satisfaction, we can find that in any work that we do, if we trust that God is the one who puts us wherever we are. He gives us opportunities to move on to more satisfying things sometimes. But wherever we are at any given time, and no matter what we are doing, we can and should be doing the very best that we can at that job and making the work environment better by having a servant spirit and being joyful and thankful for every good thing. Now, sometimes that's not so easy. In fact, sometimes people may resent you just because you don't join in with the complaining and gossip. We just need to believe that even if we have fewer friends in the short run because we don't join in the complaining and the gossip, that they will respect us, actually, and possibly look to us when they need help. Now, I don't recommend doing a lot of preaching on the job just because we have a captive audience. You know, just be a joyful servant as much as you can without giving the impression that you might be self-righteous. When I worked at the Safeway egg plant, where we processed eggs one summer when I was in college, there was another Christian who everyone knew had also gone to Harding, and He was very quick to speak out about his beliefs and tell others where he thought they were wrong in their beliefs and basically preach to them, especially when we were at the candling tables. We would be there for 2 hours in the first 4 hours and 2 hours in the second 4 hours. And when you were there, you were looking through the eggs, actually, with a light shining up through them. But there was another person across from you the whole time. You were just sitting there. And all you were doing was looking at eggs and pulling out the ones that had blood in them and so forth. And so, you know, a great opportunity to preach, right? They could not stand this guy, you know. And he was the least popular person by far on the job. Well, there was this other guy who was always talking to me. And he acted like he was the most worldly of anyone there. He was an African-American guy named Robert with some real guns, you know, and he actually lowered the transmission out of his car by hand under his car to work on it. You know, that was the kind of guy he was. And I could tell Robert liked me, but what he really liked to do was use the most possible four-letter words that he could in every sentence, you know, just to see if he could get the preacher student to cut him off, you know. I don't know if it was exactly the right thing to do, but I just ignored the cussing and was as friendly as I could be. Now, he never did ask me what he needed to do to be saved. Mm-hmm. But I'm almost 100% sure that he would have asked me long before he would have asked that other guy, that other Christian man who was always preaching to everyone. Mm-hmm. In Matthew's gospel, Jesus tells us to let your light shine before others that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. A friend of mine used to say that there's a difference between letting your light shine and shining your light. He said nobody likes it when you point your flashlight in their eyes at night, you know. Let them see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. That last line is the real key to job satisfaction. When we have a job that is really hard, we don't work for our own glory. We work, even in a lousy job, to glorify God. And that should make us feel good about ourselves, self-esteem, whether anyone else thinks much of the job that we have. So let's think about one more neutral thing that can distract us from what is most important, and that's recreation or entertainment. In and of themselves, recreation and entertainment, fun, is not evil. But it's not good in and of itself. Just because we're having fun, that's not a good thing. Yet it can certainly be a distraction from following Jesus. Or it can be a good thing. So maybe you can guess what I'm going to say. The best way to have the most fun is to follow Jesus. Now, in order to make this clear, we're going to need to do a little math. We cannot really effectively argue that everyone who is not a follower of Jesus is miserable all of the time. We can't even show good evidence that a lot of people who do not make any attempt to follow Jesus do not have some great fun and great laughs. Sometimes they even have that fun while they are doing evil things or are in the midst of some kind of self-gratification. So even though they're sinning, they're still enjoying themselves and having fun. Some of the things, though, that they do are not evil. They're just self-indulgent things like a lot of very expensive entertainment, you know. But if we'll do the math, then you'll see what I'm saying. If we give the entertainment or the recreation or the laughs a value, then that value does not exist in a vacuum. Therefore, we have to add or subtract everything that comes with that value. So here's what I'm saying. This may not seem very sophisticated and it's oversimplified, but it really is reality. Unbelievers do have fun. Some of them have a lot of fun. And they may make their lives good for a while. Maybe even a long time. But there's always a cost. So here's how it works. The unbeliever has fun. That fun, let's give it a value, but there's a cost and then there's the net amount of fun, okay? So we'll give the fun a value, a cost, and a net value. One of the ways that unbelievers enhance their good times is with alcohol, right? Now, I have no personal experience with this at all, so I'm not sure how much it takes for the alcohol to really make you feel good. But if it didn't work, people wouldn't do it, and I'm pretty sure that it takes more than a couple of drinks, right? I'm not going to look for any nodding heads, you know, I'm keeping my eyes down. We don't need to know who knows who has experience with this. But I'm suggesting that you have to get a little drunk before your good times are even better with alcohol. The jokes are more funny, you know, the laughter is a little louder. I have heard, you know, those who are drinking laugh. And there are fewer inhibitions to keep you from having fun. So let's just say that with a liberal amount of alcohol, you have a really good time. So let's give that a value of 90. All right? But is there a cost? Well, there are lots of potential costs. It's not always a huge cost, but there's always some cost. Just two drinks for a woman, or three drinks for a man, generally speaking, puts you at risk of the DUI, right? Mm-hmm. So let's just look at that. That will cost you fines of $1,000. We're just talking about California. Attorney fees, $3,000 to $15,000, depending on how bad the situation is. Insurance rates will be raised by $3,000 to $6,000. Towing and impound fees on your car, because they take it away from you when they arrest you, will be $500 to $1,000. It's up to the tower. The DMV, to get your license back, is going to be at least $125. There's what they call a victim restitution fund of $140. It never goes to the victims, I don't think, but that's what it's called. And then there's usually after, when you get your license back, there will be an ignition interlock device where you have to breathe into it and breathe clear in order to for the car to start. And that'll cost $350 to $500. And DUI school, $500 to $800. So the total cost of a DUI in California can be $8,615 to $24,565. And that doesn't count the cost of missing work and transportation costs if you have to take the bus or a taxi or whatever. But the greater cost is the humiliation and the way it affects your relationships. Of course, this is only the cost of a DUI. What if you actually injure yourself or someone else in an accident while driving under the influence? What if you kill someone? And this is only a beginning of the potential costs of having a little more fun with the help of alcohol. But let's stop there and subtract a cost from your fun. Let's say you have a lot of alcohol enhanced fun over the years without ever getting a DUI, but then it happens. Well, what would we say is the cost of all that fun that you've had all these years? Even if you don't kill someone or end up in bed with someone you barely know because you were loosened up, or you get into a fight at a bar, or you find out that you are an alcoholic whose life becomes dominated by your illness, I'm suggesting the cost of drinking to enhance your fun will eventually be more than the value of the enhanced fun. So, cost, what, 95? So what does that come out to? A net amount of fun that is negative 5. All your fun becomes a net negative with one incident. Now, without going into the sad details of what can happen, let's just consider the potential cost of being less sexually repressed. In other words, the cost of satisfying every sexual desire we have without restraint. Especially for men, but under some circumstances for women too, it's very appealing to have more of that kind of pleasure and no guilt. Well, what if we give it the same value as alcohol-enhanced fun? Okay, let's give it a 90. Big time fun sometimes, but what are the potential costs? Pregnancy, abortion, diseases, self-respect, might even cost you a marriage. Any one of those can make the cost of the pleasure or fun greater than the value. So if we did the same thing, you know, with the Jesus followers fund, how is that going to come out? All right? Well, Jesus followers also have fun, right? Okay. So let's give each thing a value, a cost, and a net value. Let's just say that we do have a little less fun without alcohol in some situations. You know, we're a little more reserved. We're a little more shy. I'm not convinced it has to be that way, but if it is, I don't think it's very much less fun to spend good times with fellow followers, even with non-believers, without getting a little drunk yourself. But let's just say that it's 10% less fun, okay? Well, what are the costs of the fun that we do have? If it costs us anything, you know, it's not much. But I'm saying it doesn't cost us anything if we treat each other the way that Jesus treated others while we're having our fun. In other words, if you're not bullying people or gossiping or, you know, you can, people, Christians joke around too at the expense of others. But if we do, you know, if we're having fun in the way that Jesus would have fun, it doesn't cost us anything. We could leave it there and our lives would be considerably better than life without Jesus. You know, we'd come up, it costs us nothing. We have a net value of 80. It's a lot better than the negative 5 that we gave to the fund that unbelievers had. And then what about sex? Well, for followers of Jesus, we get to marry and share our bodies with each other without guilt. But the best thing is that it's better than just sexual pleasure because it's really intimacy. We become one with our wives and husbands, and God brings blessings out of our oneness. And so, you know, I'd say it has to have at least a value of 90 and no cost. And so it's much greater than the value that an unbeliever ends up with when they're living just for themselves. Now, I'm obviously just making up numbers. And there are followers of Jesus who have experienced more hard times and less fun times because of their faith. And eventually, Jesus' followers, his first followers, certainly had some pretty hard times. Let's not kid ourselves. But Jesus will later put it this way when Peter, he's the one that was called Simon, when we read this, Jesus renamed him. And so when Peter later on says, "We left everything to follow you," this is what Jesus says. Jesus replied, "No one who has left home or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or fields for me in the gospel," fields by that he means wealth, businesses, possessions, "will fail to receive 100 times as much in this present age, homes, brothers, sisters, mothers, children, and fields, along with them persecutions, and in the age to come, eternal life." Jesus didn't oversimplify things. He didn't, you know, pretend that everything was going to be wonderful if they would just follow him. But if you think that my number comparisons were taking too much away maybe from the fun of unbelievers and giving too much credit to the fun of Jesus' followers, think about what Jesus is saying here. Jesus is saying it's not even close. We're 100 times better off than those without our faith, even with persecutions, because we have an unlimited life, even if this part of the life gets limited or cut off. So, is there a cost to following Jesus? Well, yes. But let's return to that last question from last week and add what we've seen this week. When you add it all up, is your God, the way you view your God, the way you view your life because you follow Jesus, is it good news or bad news for our world in the way that you present yourself in this world? If we don't get much better, if we don't get how much better the life of a Jesus follower is, then we are not sharing the good news with those around us. If we don't believe it ourselves, whatever we do share with them about Jesus isn't going to be good news. We may even be misrepresenting God and leading people to believe that he's just trying to spoil our fun. So we need to drop our nets, so to speak, and follow Jesus, even if it involves sacrifice and leads to persecution. But we need to enjoy the journey, no matter what. And we really can. We really can. Let's pray. Our Father, we know that it is sometimes a challenge to live in this world, at our jobs and in our homes and just around friends who seem to be having so much fun, seem to be sometimes doing so much better than we are in certain ways. But Father, we know that it is better to follow Jesus. We just pray that you will help us to keep our eyes open to the realities, not just of the trouble that others have when they aren't following Jesus, but to all of the blessings that we have every day. Help us to spend more time in gratitude and thankfulness and less time begging for things and wishing that things were different. Father, as we do this, help us to share our joy with others. Help us to never doubt that it will be so much better in the end, even if we are having trouble in this life. But help us also to believe that things will usually change for the better in this life. And help us to ask for that, but most of all, to thank you for that when it happens. Help us to recognize and give you the glory and the honor so that others see us and glorify you as we do. We pray these things in Jesus' name.